that thing, dude?
It started with a leak.
My gosh.
Grainy military footage showing objects defying explanation.
They're all going against the wind. The wind's 120 knots to the west.
In 2017, Pentagon officials confirmed the videos were real.
I think it is arrogant of us to think that we are alone in the universe.
While the government has kept its investigation mostly classified, a small team of scientists at Harvard launched their own, building artificial intelligence to scan the sky for UAP and sharing everything they find.
Humanity came to exist only over the past few million years. That's one part in 10,000 of the age of the universe. And we know that we are not at the center of the universe. So if you arrive to a play and you arrive just at the end of the play and you are not at the center of stage, the play is not about you.
This is the Galileo Project, and it might be the most serious scientific effort yet to answer the question, are we alone? In 2021, the U.S. government released an official report confirming more than 140 sightings of unidentified aerial phenomena. Shortly after, Avi Loeb launched the Galileo Project, a scientific effort to investigate what the government could not. 2 years ago, we started looking into this story. We had heard that Harvard was embarking on a project to build artificial intelligence software and deploy this observatory housed at an undisclosed location in somewhat rural Massachusetts to begin trying to detect UAP or UFOs.
My name is Avi Loeb. I'm a professor of science at Harvard University, the director of the Institute for Theory and Computation, and the head of the Galileo Project at Harvard University.
The Galileo Project is a series of scientific projects aimed at exploring the possibility of extraterrestrial life. There were a few aspects of this research that really interested me as a technology and cybersecurity reporter. This topic of UAP, you know, fits very neatly into this category of national security threat. You also have the AI and technology issue to potentially detect and potentially mitigate a very serious national security threat. We felt like this story and this research, you know, really dived into an interesting application of AI software, the likes of which we hadn't seen before. So, Professor Loeb, do you want to tell us a little bit about where we are and what we're looking at?
We are at the first Galileo Observatory. We are testing all the instruments, and then we will make a copy of it and place it in many locations. We hope to have hundreds of copies.
This isn't a typical observatory. A network of cameras and specialized sensors is recording the entire sky 24 hours a day. That data is then fed into artificial intelligence software built from scratch and trained to filter out planes, birds, and other known objects. The goal is to identify any anomalies and collect as much data as possible about them.
When I think of observatory, I think of a giant telescope on the top of a hill. I don't think of a patch of blacktop with some instruments that I've never seen. It might look unusual to people who are seeing it.
If you have just one giant telescope, then you're looking at a small portion of the sky, very often smaller than the size of the moon. As a result, you might miss objects crossing the sky. And that's what happens in astronomical observations because they don't care about things near Earth. They focus on very distant sources. But we care about objects passing overhead. And for that, we need to look at the entire sky at all times.
Avi isn't working alone. A group of Harvard researchers is leading the development of the AI software powering the Galileo Project.
I was interested in the topic of UAP since I was in high school. UAP stands for Unidentified Anomalous Phenomenon. I was very intrigued by all the stories and the patterns that seemed to be coming up again and again. And it was a little bit of a mystery to me why that wasn't a topic worthy of research.
Ultimately, as scientists, you should be curious about the world around you. And data is what answers the questions that you come up with.
Richard Cloetti and Laura Domine are postdoctoral researchers at Harvard. They are full-time staff assigned to the Galileo Project. They are both accomplished scientists in their own right. You know, Richard is a computer scientist. Laura is a physicist. These are the kind of scientists who have the world at their fingertips in terms of potential employment opportunities. What's really interesting about this story to us is that they've chosen to lean into their personal interests in the topic of UAP and the search for extraterrestrial life. They want to make this work of attempting to detect UAP something that's more accepted mainstream.
We do have sensors pointed at the sky in different locations. The military is looking at it from satellites and from the ground. The big difference is they're always looking for something that is known. And we are looking to classify everything that is known so that we can focus on the unknowns.
For building models that are able to detect UAP, it's quite a long, involved process. First of all, you need a model that is trained and capable of detecting objects in the sky, classifying them. And even just to get into that step has been a monumental task because there's currently no models out there which are capable of detecting objects in the sky with high accuracy. Most models have been built for detecting and classifying things on the ground, people, cars, cats. And so we had to really go ahead and train a model from scratch.
What we are seeing here is a pan, tilt, zoom camera, basically a security camera that we are developing software for so that it will zoom on objects of interest in the sky. This is a spectrometer attempting to detect any emission from sources that transmit radio waves.
We're building an array of instrumentation that we are deploying over a pretty large area of land, and these instrumentations monitor the entire electromagnetic spectrum.
We're also looking at a different distance. Usually observatories look at space, right, beyond the atmosphere. And we are focused on objects within the atmosphere, so in low altitude.
The main workhorse is actually this set of infrared cameras that we call the Dalek, a collection of 8 cameras looking at the entire sky.
Everything we're doing here is brand new, so to speak. And even if at the end of it we find nothing, it's still a result. We're still finding that there's nothing there. So obviously we prefer to find something anomalous, but also just the whole process of actually developing these technologies and measuring the entire electromagnetic spectrum is an incredibly important task in and of itself.
To date, the team has tracked and classified hundreds of thousands of objects, most of them explainable. The system is still new, and the search, they say, is just getting started. But Avi has become a polarizing figure because of this work. His interest in the topic began in 2017, after a telescope in Hawaii spotted a strange, football field-sized object in space called Oumuamua.
A lot of academia works on reputation, and there has been a lot of stigma on this topic that people are not ready to shake off.
People are entitled to criticize all they want. Ultimately, data is what's going to solve this mystery.
I get attacked personally on the research I'm doing, and it clearly touches a nerve in our human existence to admit that we might not be the smartest in the universe, that there might be someone else out there. I don't fight with them. To me, the highest level is direct evidence.
This is Harvard AI, Laura and Richard, take one.
The past 2 years have been fulfilling. It has been what I was hoping to do, which is to take sensors, calibrate them, and put them out there in the field in service of UAP research. And in the process, showcasing to our colleagues in academic research that this is something you can do while following the scientific method. The point of this section is to show how we would rigorously quantify how many objects we count in our data set. So in this example, over 5 months, we collected about 500,000 objects that we reconstructed with a 95% confidence level. So this is an example of rigorous analysis that we plan to repeat for other instruments.
The stigma attached to UAP is real and powerful and challenges national security.
In recent years, there has been increasing public disclosure of government involvement in the unidentified anomalous phenomena topic. Numerous pilots and government officials have come forward to describe their experiences, and Congress has elevated the issue to a top national security concern.
As we convene here, UAP are in our airspace, but they are grossly underreported. These sightings are not rare or isolated, they are routine. parts of our government are aware of more about UAP than they let on. But excessive classification practices keep crucial information hidden.
One of the most important moments in UFOlogy history was the disclosure in 2017 of a trio of military videos of suspected UAP.
Well, if there's a good thing, it's rotating.
You see objects that are doing things that don't seem to be possible. And then most importantly, you have the pilot observations. You hear the audio of these pilots processing what they're seeing.
Dude, this is a going on, bro. There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the ASA. My gosh.
2024, the U.S. Department of Defense announced the Gremlin Project, which appears from the limited information the Pentagon has disclosed about it, to be very similar to the Galileo Project. It's a pretty secretive project. The few details the Pentagon has disclosed indicate that the Gremlin Project tracks very closely with what Avi and Richard and Laura are doing here at Harvard with their observatory. It's a constellation of sensors that the Pentagon has deployed at an undisclosed national security site somewhere in the US where there have been multiple UAP sightings. It's a closed source project, and that's very different than the Galileo Project, which is totally open source. Everything they learn will be published in peer-reviewed papers to the public. So the government is looking at this issue, the Defense Department specifically, is looking at this issue from a national security perspective. Harvard and the Galileo Project are looking at this from a very different perspective. They're looking at this from a scientific perspective, which may have security aspects to it, but is not strictly based on security concerns. One of the byproducts of this increased disclosure by the US government, as limited as it has been, is it has destigmatized the topic of even addressing UAP.
There is some wild-looking crap in the skies.
The fact that people can now call up law enforcement and say, I think we're seeing a UFO, that's actually a really big difference from just a few years ago, where a lot of people would be embarrassed to make that phone call.
We have ignition, and we have liftoff. We have liftoff of the Titan Centaur carrying the first of two Voyager spacecraft to extend man's senses farther into the solar system than ever before.
I think that most likely our first encounters will be with technological gadgets. And they need to be autonomous because the senders are very far away. They cannot wait for guidance. And so they have to have a brain of their own, most likely artificial intelligence, and then maybe use raw materials that they find on the planet that they visit to construct anything they need, including fuel themselves or self-replicate. And so I imagine it might be the new version of the imitation game that Alan Turing was talking about 90 years ago. He thought about AI systems imitating humans. I'm thinking about our own AI systems having kinship with extraterrestrial AI systems and trying to imitate them because they're much more advanced than our AI systems.
The community of UAP researchers has definitely grown over the past 2 years. We have a high school student who asked to join and contribute to our research. And Keith was very specific that he wanted to work on this topic on UAP, and he was able to make contributions to our paper. Having young students reach out saying that they want to do research on this topic specifically out of everything else is incredibly meaningful. It gives me hope that as a research field, this is going to blossom, and this is only the beginning.
And so the lesson, the moral of this story, is that we should keep searching. It's a path that was not taken, and therefore there might be low-hanging fruit. That is my goal within the Galileo Project, to pick up this low-hanging fruit.
The Galileo Project isn't waiting for government answers or permission. It's asking a bigger question. Can science lead where secrecy won't?
We are trying to figure out the answers without relying on government, because the government is not a scientific organization and is not geared up to figuring out the truth about interstellar space.
The project is open source, built by university researchers, powered by AI, and driven by a question humanity has carried for centuries.
Whatever we find about this phenomenon, whatever is behind it, it will be interesting because it will bring an answer to a question that has been puzzling people for 50 years or more.
If the truth really is out there, then the more pressing question may not be, are we alone? It's whether we'd recognize the evidence or choose not to believe it. And if this small team at Harvard finds it first, will the world be ready to listen?